अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह वस्सलातु वस्सलाम अला रसूलिल्लाह व अला आलिहि व सहाबिहि अजमईन अम्मा बाद अऊज़ु बिल्लाहि मिनश शैतानिर रजीम बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम वमा खलक़तुल जिन्न वल इंसा इल्ला लियअबुदून बिस्मिल्लाहिर रहमानिर रहीम अल्लज़ी खलक़ल मौत वल हयाता लियब्लुकुम लियब्लुवकुम अय्युकुम अहसनु अमला रब्बि इशरह ली सदरी ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي the honorable scholars speakers the respected guests my respected elders my dear brothers and sisters and the millions of viewers who are watching this program live on Peace TV I welcome all of you with the islamic greetings assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. The topic of this last lecture, of the last session, of the last day of the 10th International Islamic Conference, "Peace: The Solution for Humanity," is. The purpose of our life. How many of us have really ever thought in their life, what is the purpose of our life? How many of us have ever thought, what is the purpose of our existence? What are we doing here? Why are we here? Let us start analyzing right from here itself. I request all the people in the audience, all of you, if you have ever thought in your life, what is the purpose of your life, please raise your hand. I would like to know amongst the audience, how many of you have ever thought in your life, what is the purpose of your life? Fine, maybe I can see 10, 50, maybe 100 hands, an audience of more than 100,000. That's less than 0.1%. Some may have felt shy to raise their hand. So surely I can say less than 1% of the human beings have ever thought in their life what is the purpose of our life. Is it required that should we know what is the purpose of our life? To help you, let me give you an example. Once a man, when he was traveling and when he came at a crossroad, he asked the passerby, where does this road lead to? The passerby asked him, where do you want to go? The man replied, anywhere. The passerby answered, then take any road, it will make no difference. That traveler, he had no goal. Whatever actions he did, whatever deeds he did, it made no difference because he wanted to go anywhere. And many of us are leading our life in the same way. Let me give you one more example. Imagine there is a builder who starts constructing his building, and he lays the foundation and he digs a big hole for the foundation. And when you ask him, how many stories is your building going to be? He says, I don't know. How many square feet is the built up area? He says, I haven't thought of it. The builder has got no goal at all. Once there was a man who told his neighbor, your dog always chases vehicles and cars. I wonder, will your dog ever catch up with any car? The neighbor replied, I don't wonder whether he'll catch up or not. I wonder if my dog catches up with the car, what will he do? The man who asked him, will the dog ever catch up with the car? He's short-sighted. The neighbor who was the owner of the dog, he was far-sighted. Even if he caught up with the car, what will he do? What is the purpose of his goal? And unfortunately, many of us, we are leading our lives same fashion, just like the dogs. You know, people do graduation and you ask them, why are you doing graduation? And they don't know the reason. Just because they want to be a graduate. What will you do after you finish your graduation? I haven't thought of it yet. Most of us are leading our lives like that traveler or like the dog who's chasing cars, absolutely without a purpose. Many of us, we copy goals of others without scrutinizing it. When we ask a student, why are you doing commerce? So he will reply, because my friend is doing commerce. Many people, they emulate and they copy the actors, the models, without realizing what they're doing. Once a person comes from the village to Bombay to become a millionaire. And when the question was asked to him, why have you come to Bombay? So he gives a reply that I have seen Amitabh Bachchan in the Hindi movie. He's a pauper, he comes to Bombay and he becomes a multi-millionaire overnight. That is the reason we find many people coming from outside Bombay and they're settling in Bombay to become a multi-millionaire overnight. And that is the reason you find that the slums in Bombay are increasing. Many times we see actors and models, they are brand ambassadors and they endorse certain products. There was a person who purchased a new car, Hyundai Santro i10. And when the question was asked, why have you chosen this particular car, Hyundai Santro i10? So he says, my favorite actor, Shah Rukh Khan, he owns Santro Hyundai i10. I doubt whether Shah Rukh Khan ever sat in Hyundai Santro i10 except in the advertisement. He may be owning a Mercedes or a BMW or somewhat similar. I doubt whether he owns a Santro. You know, Shah Rukh Khan endorsed the watch Tag Heuer. He's a brand ambassador of the watch Tag Heuer. And we find many of his fans buying Tag Heuer. I wonder what has Tag Heuer got to do with the acting of Shah Rukh Khan? Has that watch, has that wristwatch ever helped him in acting? I doubt whether he wore Tag Heuer before he became a famous actor also. So these are the various ways the media promotes products. And unfortunately, we blindly follow goals of other people without realizing what we are doing. Imagine there's an industrialist who buys a textile factory, and when asked, why have you bought the textile factory? He tells us that I've come to know that there is good profit in textile business. Then you ask the next question, Do you have a feasibility report? He says, no. Have you hired someone to take care of your business? Have you hired a CEO, chief executive officer? He says, no. What is the percentage of profit you will make? He says, I don't know. Where will you buy the raw materials for? He says, I haven't thought of it. Where will you sell your textile? He says, I don't know. Do you think that businessman will make profit in the textile industry? Imagine there's a person who has a goal. He wants to become the best scientist of the world. What does he do? He does a survey of all the scientists from the first human being, Adam, peace be upon him, till today. And after doing a survey, he comes to know the best scientist of human history was Isaac Newton. And his survey was correct. After that, what does he do? To become like Isaac Newton, he starts growing long hair, curly hair like Isaac Newton. He wears shoes like Isaac Newton. He wears clothes like Isaac Newton. Do you think he will become a successful scientist? Such people have a goal, but the planning is wrong. They have a planning. They did a survey of the scientist, but the planning is wrong. Coming to the basic question. What is the purpose of our life? What is the purpose of our existence in this world? Who do you think would be the best person to reply to this question, what is the purpose of our life? Do you think it's Dr. Zakir Naik? Surely the answer is no. Do you think the scientist can answer this question? The answer is no. Do you think the philosopher can answer this question? The answer is no. The best answer to this question, what is the purpose of our life, can be given by our Creator, God Almighty, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. And I started my talk by quoting a verse from the glorious Quran, from Surah Zariyat, chapter number 51, verse number 56, where Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have created the jinns and the men but to worship me. I have created the jinn and the men only to worship me. The Arabic word used here is ibadah, coming from the root word abd, which means servant, which means slave. Ibadah means servitude, means worship. It means obedient submission. In short, ibadah means worship or obeying the commandments of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, of our Creator Almighty God. Whatever Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, Almighty God, commands us, if we obey, it is called as ibadah, it is called as worship. For example, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala says that you have to follow the five pillars. So if you believe in Tawheed, believe there is no God but Allah, then you are doing ibadah, then you are worshipping Allah. If you pray, if you offer salah, you are doing ibadah, you are worshipping Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. If you give zakat, obligatory charity, you are doing ibadah, you are worshipping Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. If you fast, you are doing ibadah, you are worshipping Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran that you have to provide neighborly needs. So if you take care of your neighbor, as Quran says in Surah Maun, chapter number 107, verse number 1 to 7, then you are doing ibadah, you are worshipping Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. If you abstain from the things Almighty God Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala has told you to abstain from, then you are doing ibadah. If you abstain from having alcohol, you're doing ibadah. If you abstain from having pork, you're doing ibadah. You're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you abstain from stealing, cheating, telling lies, you're doing ibadah. You're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In short, when you follow the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're doing ibadah, you're worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And every act of a human being can be converted into worship if you follow two criteria. Number one is, the act should be done only and only for the pleasure of our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Point number two, the act should be done according to the sunnah, the way the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has done. If you have these two things in your act, every act of yours can be converted into ibadah, can be converted into worship. Whenever you buy an equipment, along with equipment, you get an instruction manual. If you allow me to call the human being a machine, you'll have to agree that the human being is the most complicated machine on the face of the earth. Don't you think that this human being, this machine, requires an instruction manual? The last and final instruction manual for the human beings, it is the glorious Quran. The glorious Quran, the last and final commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last and final instruction manual for the human beings. The do's and don'ts, how a human being should lead his life, is given in this instruction manual, the glorious Quran. Many people ask me the question, why does Almighty God want us to worship Him? Is He hungry of our worship? Why does He want us to praise Him? Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. Is Almighty God hungry for praises? Allah replies in the glorious Quran, in Surah Fatir, chapter number 35, verse number 15. O ye men, it is you who need Allah. And Allah is free of all wants, worthy of all praises. The Quran says in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 15, O ye men, it is you who need Allah. Allah is free of all wants and worthy of all praises. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to worship Him and to praise Him is not for His benefit. It is for our benefit. When we say Allahu Akbar, it does not make Allah great. Allah is already the greatest, irrespective whether you say Allahu Akbar or not. Allah will yet remain the greatest. It will make no difference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the reason Allah wants us to praise Him is because He knows the human psychology. We human beings, whenever we praise someone, whenever we know who someone who's great and famous, we but natural tend to follow his advice. For example, if your mother has a heart attack and you have an option, there's a layman who comes and gives you advice, will you follow his advice or a person who you know is the best heart specialist in the world and he's willing to give you free advice? Whose advice will you take? Will you take the advice for your mother from the best heart specialist in the world or from a layman? But naturally, because you know the heart specialist is famous, people keep on praising him, you indirectly tend to follow his advice. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to praise Him. He is the greatest. Allah is the greatest. Allah is the most knowing. Allah is the most wise. So that the moment when we say He is the most wise, when He gives us the advice, we indirectly tend to follow it. If we don't agree, He's most wise, most knowledgeable, then the chances we will follow it otherwise is less. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to worship him and to praise him, not so that it will benefit him, but it will benefit us. Allah says in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 15, O Iman, it is you who need Allah. Allah is free of all wants, worthy of all praises. Let me give you an example. Suppose there's a couple who's married for several years and they don't have any children. But natural, most of such couples, they will feel sad. You have another couple who's married and they have a child. They bring him up with love and affection. After he reaches the age of 15 or 16, that child dies. But natural, these parents will be sad. The first parents who did not have children, they'll feel sad. But the first group of couples who do not have any children, they'll feel sad. But the second group of parents who have children, and after they have brought them up, when they reach the teenage and when they die, they will feel more sad. Now you have a third category of parents who have children. They bring them up with love and affection. They take care of them. But when they grow and they become an adult, they don't ask about their parents. They don't take care of their parents. What would you call such kind of children? Surely you will call them inhuman, unjust, and ungrateful. All of us will agree that if your parents, they bring you up with love and affection, take care of you, give you all the facilities, once you grow and become an adult, you don't even talk to them, you don't care about them, you don't even meet them, surely such children will be called unjust, ungrateful, and inhuman. If you agree with this point, imagine, what would you call those human beings who are ungrateful to their creator? Our creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, almighty God, has not only created you, he has even created your parents. So don't you think that we should thank our creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Shouldn't we be obedient to him? How many of us ever thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bounties, for the blessings that he has bestowed upon us? How many of us? Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has given us life. He has given us the blessings of this world, food, clothing, shelter. Can you imagine if you don't get water for a few days? But naturally you'll die. How many of us have ever thanked our creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the water he has provided us? Have you ever thought that the air we breathe, if we don't get this air for a few minutes, what will happen to us? But naturally we'll die. How many of us have ever thanked our creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the air he has provided us? Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Ibrahim, chapter number 14, verse number 34, if you count the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not be able to number it. And man indeed is unjust and ungrateful. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Dariyat, chapter number 100, verse number 6. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لِرَبِّهِ لَقْنُودٌ. Verily, human beings are to their Lord very ungrateful. Allah says this in several places, that verily, human beings to their Lord are very ungrateful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to worship Him and to praise Him. Not that it will benefit Him, because it will benefit us, benefit the human beings. Imagine when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes to know that after you have followed His advice, it's benefiting His creation, He feels happy. For example, if there's a doctor who's giving free treatment and free advice to the poor patients, imagine if that patient doesn't listen to the advice of the doctor, how does the doctor feel? And if you follow the advice of the doctor, it will not benefit the doctor. He's giving you free treatment. It will benefit you. And once you follow his advice, the doctor is happy. At least my patient has now become healthy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far superior than all the doctors in the world. It's mentioned, Huwa Shafi. It is He who cures. So when you worship Him, when you follow His advice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy, because the moment you praise Him and you follow His advice, it benefits His creation. It benefits the human beings and it pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is not pleased when you worship Him and praise Him because it benefits Him. He is pleased because it benefits the human beings, His creations. And even after you commit sins, you commit crimes, the moment you repent, the moment you ask for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately forgives you. Allah mentions this in several places in the Quran. Wallahu ghafurur rahim. And Allah is of forgiving and most merciful. In several places, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 25. In Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 74. In Surah Al-Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 49. In Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 119. In Surah Az-Zumur, chapter number 39, verse 53. In Surah Buruj, chapter number 85, verse number 14. Wallahu ghafurur rahim. For verily, Allah is of forgiving and most merciful. Even though you don't obey Him, even though you disobey Him, you don't follow His advice, the moment you repent, the moment you ask for forgiveness, Allah forgives you and He's happy. He's pleased that you made a mistake. These human beings are my creation. I forgive them. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 48. And in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 116. If Allah pleases, He will forgive any sin. But the sin of shirk, associating partners with God, joining partners with God, Allah will never forgive. For anyone who has done shirk, associated partners with God, he has done a heinous sin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive any sin if He pleases. But the sin of shirk, if you die as a mushrik, if you die associating partners with God, and before your death, if you do not repent, if you do not ask for forgiveness, Allah will never forgive you. So one greatest sin from which all humankind should abstain from, number one, is shirk, associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, joining God with Almighty God. People very often ask this question. We understand God has created the human beings for worshipping Him. But why this? What is so special about the human beings? why has he created us? Human beings are a unique creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The human beings and the jinns are the only creation who have a free will of their own. All the other creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they have submitted their will to Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they do not have any free will. They obey Allah 100%. They have no choice. But the human beings and the jinns, they have option to either obey or to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah 13, chapter number 95, verse number 4, verily, we have created the human beings in the best of molds. وَلَّقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمِ. For verily, we have created the human beings in the best of molds. Human being is the best creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Besides being created in the best of molds, we are unique. We have a choice of either obeying or disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After a free will has been given to you, and if you obey the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are superior to the angels. Because the angels, they have no free will. They obey Almighty God without a free will. So if after a free will has been given to you, and if you obey and submit your will to Almighty God, you are superior to the angels. You know, when we say, oh, this man is an angel, it has two meanings. One is, maybe it's an insult, because human beings are superior to angels. But it means that you are a human being after free will is given to you, but you are obeying the laws of God like an angel, so it makes you superior. A human being who's obeying like the angel, so then it makes you superior. But if you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you go against his commandments, then you become the brother of the devil and you become a satan. So human beings have a choice to either obey the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to become superior than the angels, or to disobey him and become like the satan. The choice is yours. When we analyze that, why has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why has he created us? It is because we are the best of creations. We have an option of either obeying him, or we have the option of disobeying him. If we obey him, we become superior to the superior than the angels. If we disobey him, we become like the Satan. And this life, Allah says, is a test for us. I started my talk by also quoting one more verse of the Quran, of Surah Mulk, chapter number 67, verse number 2, where Allah says, أَلَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Your death and life, Allah has created death and life to test which of you is good in deeds. Allah has created death and life to test which of the human beings are good in deed. So this life is a test for the hereafter. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 185, kullu nafsin zaiqatul maut, every soul shall have a taste of death. Your final recompense will be on the day of judgment. And whosoever has been saved from the fire and has entered the garden of paradise, he has achieved the objectives of this world. For verily, this life is goods of chattels and deception. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 155. Be sure, we shall test you with something of fear or hunger, or loss in goods or lives, or the fruits of your toils, and give glad tidings to those who patiently persevere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created this life for us and death as a test, to test which of the human beings is good indeed. And surely Allah will test you with fear, with hunger, with loss of goods, with loss of wives. And what you have earned in your full life, the fruits of your toils, He will test different people in different ways. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 71, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows His sustenance more freely on some of the human beings as compared to others. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 165, that He has raised some of the human beings in higher ranks above others, and He has bestowed gifts on some of them so that He will test them. If Allah raises you in ranks and gives gifts to you, bestows bounties on you, be prepared. Allah is testing you. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Anfal, chapter number 8, verse number 28, that your wealth and your children, they are a test for you. The wealth that Almighty God has given you, the children that Almighty God has given you, they are a test for you. Allah says in Surah Munafiqun, chapter number 63, verse number 9, let not the love of your wealth and children take you away from the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 2, do not think just by saying you believe, Allah will let you go and Allah will not test you. So just by saying, I am a Muslim, I am a believer, I am a mu'min, Allah says in the Quran, don't think that Allah will not test you. Allah will surely test you. And only if you pass in the test, will you get paradise. Just by saying, I am a Muslim, I am Muhammad, I am Zakir, I am Abdullah, will not take you to Jannah. Allah will surely test you. And if you pass in the test, then inshallah go to Jannah. What are the criteria for a person to go to paradise, for a person to attain Jannah? And the answer to this question is given in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1-3, where Allah says, Wal Asr, innal insana lafi khusr illa allazina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bil sabr. By the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who do righteous deeds, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. For a person to attain P3, he has to do P4. P3 is, first P is the pleasure of Allah. To attain the pleasure of Allah, peace in this world and paradise in the hereafter, to attain these three P, you have to do four P's. The first P is the purity of faith. Second P is piety, righteous deeds. Third P is propagation, inviting people to truth. And the fourth P is patience and perseverance. Invite people to patience and perseverance. For any human being to attain the pleasure of Allah and peace in this world and paradise in the hereafter, he should have iman, righteous deed, that is purity of faith.
he should have amal salihat, righteous deed, piety. He should have watawasaw bil haq. He should do watawasaw bil haq. Invite people to the truth, that is, do propagation. And watawasaw bil sabr. Invite people to patience and perseverance. To attain three P's, you should follow the four P's. And there's a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad. It's mentioned Sunan Tirmidhi, volume number 4, chapter number 60, hadith number 2517. Anas ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that once a man, he asked the Prophet, should I tie it, that is my camel, and trust in Allah, or should I leave it, leave my camel or trust in Allah? The Prophet said, tie it, tie your camel and then trust in Allah. That does not mean that you leave your camel and then say that I've got trust in Allah, tawakkulullah, I've got trust in Allah. You can't leave your door open and then say, you know, I've got trust in Allah, no robber will come. You have to close your door and then trust in Allah. Trust in Allah is important, but also following the guidance of Allah is important. And for success, trust in Allah is the most important. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 160. If Allah helps you, none can overcome you. If Allah forsakes you, who is there then who can help you? So let the believers put the trust in Allah. Allah says in Surah An-Kabut, chapter number 29, verse number 69, that if you strive in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will open up your pathways. Says in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse 43, and Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 7, Fas'alu ahli zikri in kuntum la ta'lamun. If you don't know, ask the person who is knowledgeable, ask the one who possesses the message. So for success, first is belief in Allah. Number two is striving, doing jihad in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number three is ask the person who knows. Even planning is important. Even goal setting is important. And we find when we read the books of management gurus, there are various goal settings that have been given by them. But for me, the best planning, the best goal setting is Islamic. I-S-L-A-M-I-C. I is for Islamic. Your goal should be according to the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Your goal should be based on the teachings of Quran and the teachings of Sahih Hadith of the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It should be Islamic, number one. S, your goal should be specific. It should be focused. Your goal can't be vague. Let me give you an example. Once there was a teacher who was teaching archery to his students. And he tells the students who were learning bow and arrow, aim at that bird who's sitting on the treetop. All of them take aim. He said, don't release until I give you command. So he asked the first student, have you taken aim? He said, yes. What do you see? He says, I see the forest, I see the trees, and I also see the bird. He asked the second student, what do you see? He says, sir, I see the tree, I see the branch of the tree, and I see the bird. He asked the third student, what do you see? The third student replies, I only see the branch of the tree, and the bird and the eye of the bird. He asked the fourth student, what do you see? The fourth student replies, sir, I only see the eye of the bird and nothing else. The teacher says, let the arrow go. And the arrow hits the eye of the bird. Your goal should be specific. It should be focused. It should not be like the traveler who wants to go nowhere. Not like the dog who's running after car without purpose. Number three, L. L is for lucrative. It should be profitable. Number one, it should be profitable in the hereafter, akhira. And if possible, simultaneously, it can even be profitable in this world. But more important is the akhira. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 201. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasnatan wa fil akhirati hasnatan wa qina azaban nar. O Lord, give us the good in this world and the hereafter, and save us from the torment of hellfire. So it should be lucrative, it should be profitable, number one in the hereafter, and then secondly in this world. But more important is the hereafter and then the world. Let not your profit of this world take you away from the profit of the hereafter. Fourth is A. A, it should be apt, it should be appropriate, it should be suitable. Your goal should be apt and appropriate. M is for measurable. Your goal should be measurable. And for your goal to be measurable, first it should be specific. After it is specific, it should also be measurable. For example, suppose the builder says, I want to build the tallest building in the world. The goal is specific. But to make it measurable, he does a survey. Which is the tallest building in the world? And he comes to know that Burj Al Dubai. It is 600 to 700 meters tall, specific. So now his goal is, he has to build a building which is more than 700 meters tall. It's specific and measurable. If it's measurable, it can be monitored. How much are you reaching? How much are you coming closer to your goal? I is for intention. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, chapter number 1, book of faith, hadith number 1. First hadith of Bukhari, innamal amala bin niyya. Your deeds will be judged on your intentions, and you will be rewarded for your intentions. Your intention should be to please Allah and His Rasul, Muhammad. Your intention should not be to become famous, to become popular. If that's your intention, then your goal is not correct. If your intention is to please Allah, your creator, and His messenger, surely you will be rewarded in the hereafter, and inshallah, Allah will reward you even in this world. Last, C, it should be consistent. It should be consistent till the time you achieve the goal, if the goal is time bound. If it's not time bound, it should be consistent forever. For example, if your goal is, I want to read Quran at least once in the month of Ramadan, so then you have a target. I will read one juz every day. Then you are consistent. Every day in the month of Ramadan, you read one juz of the Quran. At the end of Ramadan, you will finish the Quran at least once. If your goal is not time bound, maybe you want to say, I want to read the Quran daily. Then you set up a target. I will read Quran every day, half juz or maybe one juz. And then you start, the moment you achieve reading half juz or one juz a day, keep on being consistent till the end of your life. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Muslim, volume number 1, Book of Salah, chapter number 272, hadith number 1711. He said, that once a person asked the Prophet, which is the best of deeds which is loved by Allah? So the Prophet said, Allah loves those deeds which are done consistently, even if they are small. It is far better than bigger deeds which are done only once. So deeds which are done consistently are far superior than deeds which are done once in a while, even if they are greater. So the goal is Islamic. I for Islamic, S for specific focused, L for lucrative profitable, A for apt appropriate, M for measurable, which can be monitored, I for intention, should be to please Allah and His Rasul, and C, it should be consistent. Let me give you an example. Some of us may be aware of the history of Vilma Rudolph. Vilma Rudolph was a girl who was born and she had polio since childhood. And the doctors, they put braces on her legs. And they said, this girl will never set foot on the earth. Her mother, she encouraged the child and she told Vilma, you, what you want to do, you will be able to do. And the mother encouraged her daughter. Vilma, at the age of 9, she removed the braces and she wanted to be the fastest woman on the earth. That was a desire, that was a goal. Removing the braces at the age of 9, at the age of 13, for the first time in her life, she takes part in a race and she loses. She comes out last, but yet she's consistent. She keeps on striving. She loses, again she strives. A day comes when she qualifies for the Olympics. And this is a true story. It's not an anecdote. It's not a fairy tale. Once she qualifies for the Olympics, in 1960 Olympics, she comes out first in 100 meters amongst the women. She gets a gold medal. She also gets the gold medal in 200 meter sprint amongst the women. She also wins the gold medal for the 400 meter relay, 100 into 4 amongst the women. She gets 3 gold medals in the 1960 Olympics. And she creates history. A paralyzed, a paralytic woman who had polio, she becomes the fastest woman on the face of the earth in the year 1960. Now, when we analyze the goal setting done by Vilma, and if you have read books of the management gurus, she fulfills all the criteria. Those who have read about the SMART goals, I don't want to go into detail. But let us verify how much she fulfills of the main target of the creator, Islamic. Number one, was the goal Islamic? Was the goal according to Quran and Sunnah? I don't know her personal life, but I knew that she was not a Muslim. I don't know whether she did for the creator or not. Number two, was the goal specific? Yes, it was specific. She wanted to be the fastest woman on the face of the earth. Was it lucrative? Was it profitable? Yes. For this world, it was profitable. She gets fame, she gets honor. But for the hereafter, Allahu Alam. I doubt whether in the hereafter, this Olympic gold medal will bring a profit. Unless she dedicates the gold medal towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A, was it apt and appropriate? Yes, it was. M, was it measurable? Yes, she could measure who is the fastest woman on the face of the earth. Maybe the timing is somewhere close to 9 seconds or 10 seconds or 11 seconds. Measurable. And she practiced. She achieved the goal. I, what was the intention? If intention was fame, surely she got it. Was the intention to please Allah? I doubt. See, was it consistent? Yes, it was consistent. She consistently practiced even though she lost, till she won and became the fastest woman on the earth. Let me give you another example to compare and show the difference between goal setting. I would like to give an example of the man, of the person who had very small means but reached the heights in his field. The man, the person who changed my life and converted me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of soul. And I'm sure you know the name of that man. He's none other than Sheikh Ahmed Didad. Let us compare his goal setting, Sheikh Ahmed Didad. And if you know the life history of Sheikh Ahmed Didad, he was only, he acquired education only to standard 6th. Because both his ends could not meet, he was forced to leave his education. After passing standard 6, he was forced to leave his education. A man with small means. He was forced to leave the country India where he was born. Then he goes to South Africa. He does a job of a salesman. He works in a furniture shop. He does the job of driving, etc. And while he was in South Africa, he used to constantly be harassed by the Christian missionaries, who used to tell, Islam is a useless religion. It is merciless. They used to attack Islam. And because he used to get harassed, a desire came in his heart that I want to reply all the allegations against Islam made by these Christian missionaries. I want to give a fitting reply to these Christian missionaries. Imagine a man only studied to standard 6. But naturally he had faith in Allah. He strived. He stumbled across a book. You know, the books which were lying in a room which had dust on it. He stumbled across a book by the name of Izharul Haq, the truth revealed by Maulana Karanvi, Rahmatullah Karanvi. And he gets the direction for his goal. That's how he started. And he strived for 40 years till the time he challenged the stalwarts of Christianity. Imagine a 6th standard pass man strive for 40 years and challenge the stalwarts of the world. So much so that in 1984, in the early 1980s, he was about to debate Reverend Jimmy Swaggart. And at that time, in 1980s, Jimmy Swaggart was the number one most powerful, most famous Christian televangelist. Just a few weeks before his debate, one of the fans of Sheikh Didat told him that, Sheikh Ahmed Didat, I'm your fan, but I want to give you an advice. This man, Jimmy Swaggart, I know him. I've studied him. Please don't debate him. He will chew you and he will spit you out. Imagine a fan of Didat giving advice to Didat. You don't debate this Jimmy Swaggart. You don't know him, I know him. He will chew you and he will spit you out. The person who was the most famous televangelist, who owned television channels, whose budget was more than $1 million a day to keep his head above water. Our Sheikh Ahmed Didat, mashallah. With Allah on his side, He goes to USA, in the hometown of that Christian missionary, in the country, very famous. He goes and he has a debate. And alhamdulillah, summa alhamdulillah, with Allah's help, he turns the tables over. Imagine, a man of small means, not even past school, leave aside being a graduate, challenges the stalwarts of Christianity, so much so that he became the biggest stumbling block for the Christianity of the world, for the Christian missionary. One man alone, Sheikh Ahmad Didat, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he challenged the whole of Christianity. Let's analyze this goal setting. Number one, the Islamic. Was it Islamic? Was it according to Quran and Sahih Hadith? Was it for Allah and His Rasul? But naturally it was. That's the reason he was able to achieve his goal. Number two, was it specific? Yes. His goal was specific. I want to reply to the allegations against Islam. Specific. I want to give a fitting reply. Remove the misconceptions about Islam that is there in the minds of the non-Muslim. Number three, was it lucrative? Was it profitable? He wanted profit in Akhirah. And inshallah, inshallah, Allah will grant him Jannah, inshallah. Besides being profitable in the Akhirah, it even profited him here. You know, a number six standard passed man in 1986, he gets the biggest award in the Muslim world. He is awarded the King Faisal Award for service in humanity. A 600 man. He didn't do for the award. Maybe he got $200,000. He didn't do it for that. Maybe for the gold King Faisal Award. He didn't do it for that. He did for Allah and His Rasul. Allah profits him in Akhirah and even in this world. Lucrative. A. Was it apt? Was it appropriate? Very apt. At the right time. His style, everything at that time. When the Christian missionaries were hammering the Muslims. Our morale was at the lowest. This man, Sheikh Ahmad Didat, he inspired thousands of youngsters, including myself. We could at least raise our head and stand. Apt. M. Was it measurable? Yes. What did he do? He collected the books of Christianity, the Christian missionaries who wrote against Islam. You know, John Gilchrist, all these books, Jimmy Swaggart, and started replying. When they attacked the Quran and Islam, he replied and he studied their scripture, Bible, used the verse of the Quran and implemented on them and he found results. Measurable. I. What was his intention? His intention wasn't to become famous. His intention wasn't to win the King Faisal Award. His intention was to please Allah and His Rasul. C. Was he consistent? Yes, he was. Imagine, he struggled and strived for 40 years. And if you know his history, his office was a small, dingy place. And he tells us that even to print a black and white pamphlet, 1,000 quantity, they used to have a meeting. Let's have a meeting. Can we print 1,000 quantity of a black and white pamphlet? MashaAllah. Consistent. Kept on striving. Till he reached his goal. The difference that we find in Wilma Rudolph and Sheikh Ahmad Didat is that the goal of Wilma Rudolph, it was short-sighted. It was more for this world. But the goal of Sheikh Ahmad Didat, it was far-sighted. And it was for the Akhirah. And Allah gave him reward. Inshallah, Allah will give him reward in the Akhirah and even gave him reward in this world. Most of us human beings, what is our purpose of life? number one purpose of our life is how to earn a living. Majority of the people, you ask them and you inquire with them, number one, the main concern is to earn a living. They are more bothered about earning a living than how to lead a life. And depending upon how much they earn, their lifestyle revolves around it. What will they eat? What will they wear? Where will they live? Which school will they study in? Which graduation course they'll take up? Everything revolves around their earnings. And these people think that if I can earn good money in this world, they have achieved the purpose. They have achieved the purpose of their life. You know, I gave the example of being focused. You know, most of us, what we do, instead of focusing on the eye of the bird and shooting, what do? We shoot and then we draw the bullseye around it. We shoot anywhere. We take up any course of graduation. Then when we ask, why have you taken this course? Oh, I haven't thought of it. Then they do speciality. Then they do super speciality. And then they try and justify why they have chosen that course. You know, people, first they think how much will they earn. And based on what will they earn, they decide how will they lead their life. This is just an apt example of shooting in the air and then drawing the bullseye. First, we have to identify what is our center. On which act does our life revolve around? Different people have different centers of their life. Some people, they are self-centered. Everything for them is themselves. They are least bothered about anyone else in the world. They are only bothered about themselves. How they lead their life, they are least bothered about others. They are self-centered. Some people, they are family-centered. Their whole life revolves around that their family is happy. They are ready to break and make any rule, irrespective whether it's right or wrong, to make their family members happy. The main aim in life is to make their family members happy. Some may be parent-centered. Some may be spouse-centered, wife-centered, husband-centered. Some may be children-centered. No, some people, to make their parents happy, they will go to any extent. Their whole rules and regulations of life is based on what their parents like and don't like. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14, that we have enjoined on the human beings to be good to their parents. In travail upon travail did the mother bore them, and in pain did she give them birth. Immediate next verse, Surah Luqman, chapter 31, verse number 15 says, but if your parents strive, do jihad, strive and struggle to make you worship somebody else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of which you have no knowledge, don't obey them. Yet, live with them with love and compassion. That means our Creator says you have to love your parents, you have to respect them, obey them, but if they tell you to go against the Creator, against Allah and His final messenger, you don't have to obey them, yet live with them with love and compassion. There are limits. Some of us, we are spouse-centered. We want to satisfy our wives, or we want to satisfy our husbands. And suppose the man's wife, she wants a very expensive diamond necklace. The person, he can't afford it. What does he do? He begs, borrows and steals, but buys that expensive diamond necklace for his wife. His goal is to satisfy his wife. Some of us, we are children-centered. We want to satisfy our children. There are cases where sometimes the son wants to go abroad for studies. The course in which he is getting admission is useless. It will not help him in the akhirah, won't help him here also. But yet, because the son wants to go abroad, this person mortgages his property and sends his sons to America and then says, "Mera beta to America mein pad raha hai." As though the objective of his life is to send his son to America to study. What are the objectives? What is the center of your life? Some of us, we are society centered. We want to know what do the other people outside our family think about us. So full life revolves around the society. Some people, they are neighbor centered. They are having competition with their neighbor. That reminds me of an anecdote. Once an angel, he comes and tells a man, "I am pleased with you. Whatever you ask, I will fulfill your desire. But there's one condition. Whatever you ask, I will give it to you, but I will give your neighbor double." So the man says, "I want a Rolex watch." So the angel gives him a Rolex watch, but gives the neighbor two Rolex watch. The man says, "I want a Mercedes car." The angel gives him a Mercedes car, but gives the neighbor two Mercedes car. The man says, "I want a big beautiful bungalow." The angel gives him a big beautiful bungalow, but next to his bungalow, there are two big beautiful bungalows given to his neighbor. So the man says, "Angel, please fulfill my last one desire." "What is it?" "Please break my one eye so that I cannot see with one eye." Imagine, he is more bothered about his neighbor than himself. He is not bothered whether his life is simple or complicated, whether he lives in poverty or luxury. He is more bothered that he should lead a better life than his neighbor. So much so that he tells the neighbor, "Break my one eye so that my neighbor's both eyes are broken." This is how we are neighbor-centered. He's not bothered whether he's happy or he can see or not see. As long as the neighbor is completely blind, I don't mind losing one eye. Neighbor-centered. Some people are friend-centered. Some people are enemy-centered. They are more bothered what are the enemies doing. What is my enemy thinking against me? So they plan strategies. If my enemy does this, I will do that. Full time, their full life goes in thinking what their enemy is doing. And you find this in various, you have businessmen thinking about the enemy, you have politicians thinking about the enemy, you have students thinking about the enemies. What are they planning? So I will counter plan. They spend most of their time in planning to counter the enemy. I would like to give a piece of beautiful advice to them, which I follow in my life. If someone throws stones at you, raise yourself so high so that the stones don't reach you. If someone throws stones at you, raise yourself so high the stones should not reach you. So where is the question of competition? Where is the question of the enemy planning against you? And there's another advice. If someone throws bricks at you, use that bricks to build your house. You know, when I was in school, I used to learn martial arts. Karate, judo. And if a big man comes and pushes you, what do? You take a sidestep, use this force to throw him over. Use this force. If someone throws bricks at you, use that brick to build your house. Some people are fame-centered. They want to get famous. The main aim is to get famous. They can break any of their principles. They can break any of their rules and regulations. Some people, they are materialistic. They are material centered. They are more bothered what do they own, what do they possess, what do they wear. And this is common, very common amongst people who are rich. And when they meet their friends, they start discussing, what brand of watch are you wearing? Is it Tiger? Is it Omega? Oh, it is Rolex. What is the strap? Is it metal strap or leather strap? What is the bezel? Oh, what kind of a dial do you have? Is it gold plated or is it diamond studded? Oh, designer watch. Parthi Philip. And most of these people who are rich, they don't have one watch. They have multiple watches. Then they start planning. Okay, this watch I wore today, next time I'll not wear the same watch when I meet my friend. So they've spent their time in planning which watch to wear for which function. These same people then start discussing about cars. What car do you have? BMW? Mercedes? Porsche? Rolls Royce? Maybach? Bentley? Designer? This is a pastime. And believe me, and very often, as though this is the identity. If they don't wear that watch, who will recognize them? If they don't travel in the car, if they don't travel in Mercedes or a BMW, who will recognize them? This is identity. This is common amongst people of big cities. On a higher level you go, they start discussing what yacht do you have? What kind of ship do you own? On a higher level, which jet do you own? I have a private jet. How many engines? People may be wondering, how come I know all the nitty-gritty of the watches, of the brands? You know the profession that I am in? Alhamdulillah. Fortunately, unfortunately, the profession that I am in, I am mixed around with all types of people, right from paupers to the kings. Allah has blessed me. Fortunately, unfortunately, I mix around with people who are paupers to the kings. And every opportunity I get, whenever I meet a person who's materialistic, I try and convey the message. And I tell them, you know, your watch may be costing thousands of dollars or tens of thousands of dollars or hundreds of thousands of dollars. My watch that I'm wearing, it cost only 1400 rupees, less than $30. I have it for several years, yet it gives the same time accuracy as your watch. Simple watch, 1400 rupees. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed me. All these brands that I mentioned, most of these brands I've got gifts. I've got gifts of these brands. All these, Omega, Rolex, many I got. And I always follow the guidance of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I give it to other dais and I give it to my staff members so that I'm away from the khutwa to shaitan. There have been occasions when my hosts, they send their private jet plane to get me into the country. There were a few occasions. Imagine the cost of the fuel of the private jet plane just to get one man. The salary of the pilot. The salary of the air hostess. The salary of hiring the airport. So I told this man that it would have been preferable that you had given me an economic ticket. A normal public transport, air, economic class. Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed. Allah has blessed my family that mashallah, we can own all these cars. We can travel in jets, alhamdulillah. But I'm a dai. So I told him, instead of spending such a big amount, you would preferably given me an economic class air ticket, I would have come and you could have given the difference in charity in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My host also, mashallah, being very clever, he told me that who can I send my jet private plane to pick up? Who is a better person than a dai of Allah? So I told him, inshallah, if a niyat was there, inshallah, I'll get the reward. His niyat was to give a servant of Allah the best of treatment, Allah will reward him. The point to be noted is, I am not telling you that all these material things are haram. They are not always haram. You have to know your objectives of life. They can become haram, they may not become haram. Let me give an example. Suppose you belong to category one, in which a person cannot afford these things. These expensive watches, expensive cars, expensive bungalows, yet he begs, borrows and steals, or he takes a loan and he wears his expensive watches, he travels in expensive cars. It is called as israf. It is haram. Who Allah has given them the means, as Allah says in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 71. We have bestowed bounties more freely on some human beings than the others. But the next verse Allah says in Surah An'am, chapter 6, verse number 165, that Allah has raised some people in higher ranks and giving gift to others so that he may test you. So if Allah has given you the means, and if you have all these things, expensive cars, expensive watches, expensive bungalows, and if your life is revolving around it, then you cannot do without it. It is your center, it is your purpose of life, yet it is haram. We have the third category of people, who Allah has given the means. They own these things, but they aren't dependent on them. They own it. We have examples of Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, who was rich, and he owned, but he wasn't dependent on it. So if you own these things, and yet you follow the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you aren't dependent on these material things, then it is mubah. It's optional. It is not haram. But the best category is the fourth category. That Allah has given you the means, and yet you don't use it. You don't acquire it. Like a beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the power he had, the fame he had, the command he had, he could have become the king of the world that time. He could have owned all the riches. But whenever he got a gift, most often, almost all the time, he gave the gifts to the sahabas. Not that it was haram to own it. If someone gives a good gift, you can keep it. It's not haram. But the Prophet, he gave it to others. The fourth category, Allah has given you the means. But yet, you spend those means in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to identify our center. What is our center? The most important center for the human being is he should be Allah centered. His purpose, his goal should be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And believe me, if you are Allah centered, that does not mean that you neglect yourself, you neglect your family, that neglect your society. If you are Allah centered, Allah says that take care of yourself. Sleep at night. Allah says that take care of your family. Allah says about your parents in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 23 and 24, that Allah has ordained that you worship none but Him, that you be kind to your parents, and if one of them or both of them reach old age, don't say a word of contempt, don't say uff to them, but address them with honor and lower to them your wing of humility and pray to the Lord to cherish them as they cherish me children. That means if you are Allah centered, you have to love your parents, you have to respect them, you have to obey them. Only when they go against Allah and His Rasul, that's the time you don't obey, but live with them with love and compassion. Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14 and 15. If you are Allah centered, that does not mean you take care of your, they don't take care of your wife. It is the hadith of a beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Hadith number 7396. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the best of the believers are those who are best to the family, especially your wife. Allah-centered doesn't mean neglecting your family, neglecting your society. Allah says in Surah Maun, chapter number 107, verse 1-7, that you provide neighborly needs. Help your neighbors. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, it's hadith in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 1, book of faith, hadith number 13, that if a person does not wish for his brother, a person is not a believer if he does not wish for his brother the same thing what he likes for himself. Let me take care of other people. So by being Allah-centered, it doesn't mean that you're neglecting, that you have to lead a life of a pauper. Your focus should be Allah. If Allah has given you wealth, see to it that use your wealth for the cause of Allah. If Allah has given you fame, use that fame for the way of Allah. If Allah has given you qualities, if Allah has bestowed gifts on you, use it for the cause of Allah. And the best example, the role model for the person who was the most Allah-centered is the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the best example of a person who is Allah-centered. And he was not a mercy only for the Muslims, he was a mercy for the whole of humankind. And Allah says in Surah Anbiya, chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to the whole of humanity, as a mercy to all the creatures, as a mercy to all the worlds. The best example for a person who had the best purpose of life, the best example converted the barbarians into human beings, for a person who changed the humankind. And when we read his history, you can speak for hours and days together. Leave aside what the Muslims have said about the beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we can give hundreds of quotations of non-Muslims who have praised the Prophet. Just to give you a few examples, George Bernard Shaw, he said, when talking about Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, I have studied him, that is Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and in my opinion, far from being an antichrist, he should be called as a savior for humanity. George Bernard Shaw. Thomas Carlyle, who was a famous historian, he was a European, a non-Muslim, he writes a book, Heroes and Hero Worship, and he gives down the history of hero, and number one hero, a hero prophet, it wasn't Jesus, peace be upon him, it wasn't Moses, peace be upon him, it was not David, peace be upon him, it was not Solomon, peace be upon him, it was Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Imagine Thomas Carlyle, a European, was a Christian, he places number one hero prophet as Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We have the example of Lamartine. Lamartine was a famous historian. He was a French who wrote the history of the Turks. And he writes, if greatness of purpose, smallness of means, and greatness of results, if these three are the criteria to judge the greatness of a person, there will be no one in modern history who would dare to compare himself with Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. If greatness of purpose, smallness of means, and astounding results are the three criteria for judging how great a person is. I dare any man in human history, modern history, who will come close to Muhammad, peace be upon him. And he continues, with all standards of humankind, there is no one who can compare himself to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Michael H. Hart is a famous historian, and he writes a book on the 100 most influential people in human history, right from Adam, peace be upon him, till present time. And number one he places is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Then I was inspired by Sheikh Ahmed Didad. Ah, this is the man. And my focus changed. And that's how, mashallah, he told me that, son, I have done research and study in Christianity and Islam. You study other religions. Christianity is like everything on a platter. Sheikh Didad did the job so well, everything on a platter. It's a cakeswalk. If you read Sheikh Didad's book, you can even debate the Pope. So then I studied Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, science, other subjects, and mashallah. As to admire the crowd that Sheikh Didad, the largest audience he addressed in Birmingham, 12,000 people. Mashallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mashallah. He opened up the pathways with his help. Mashallah, my son then became Hafiz al-Quran at the age of 13. Unique style. 1 year, 5 days a week. Unique. People said, Zakir is crazy. 1 hour every day, 5 days a week, 9 months a year, impossible. Most of the students in our school, within 2.5 to 4 years, they completed his. And one amongst them was my son. Then my son got black belt in Taekwondo. But what really pleased me was when he started giving lectures in public. At the age of 8, small lectures, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 50,000 people, 100,000 people before my talks. The first time I gave a lecture, public lecture, was the age of 27, 28. People used to tell me, oh, what a young person, 28 years used to feel. 28 years old. Sheikh Didad, 60, 70, 28 years, used to feel happy. My son, the first long public lecture of more than 1 hour 15 minutes with 119 quotations, 56 from the Quran, 52 from the Bible, and 11 ahadith with Arabic at the age of only 14, half my age. That pleased me. MashaAllah, 1 hour 15 minutes, 119 quotations without any notes. And this year, mashallah, again he gave a lecture. Just last week, last Sunday he gave a lecture. This Sunday again he gave a lecture. First misconception of Islam, concept of God. Inshallah, inshallah, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he accept his efforts. And always tell, I tell my son, that Allah has given you the means. But see to it that make your requirement small. Make your requirement less. Why? Tomorrow you may not have this luxury. Your aim is to do dawah. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fusila, chapter 41, verse number 33. وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness, and says that I'm a Muslim? Why I say a da'i? I remember when I married my wife, I told her, I'm a doctor. I can promise you only 4,000 rupees a month. 4,000 rupees is less than $100. I can only promise you 4,000 rupees a month. If you want to marry me, marry me. And mashallah, she was a teacher in the college, earning much more than what I promised her. But she also wanted to die. Mashallah. So I tell my son, make your requirements less so that if you are used to sleeping on the floor, if you are used to taking all the troubles, if you have to sacrifice and yet continue your dawah, it's easy. If you are used to luxury, and if the luxury is taken away from you, it will prevent you from continuing as a da'i. MashaAllah. I've seen to it that we have My son has slept on the floor. He has been in 7-star hotels. And everything. Train the person from young. When he's young, he should be able to take the struggle of life. Don't give him a silver spoon in the mouth, which will be difficult for him to achieve the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would like to end my talk by just summarizing. In order to achieve the purpose of your life, in different stages of your life, you have to see that you are towards the direction. Before I give these 6 points, when people take admission in our school, I normally ask them, when is the best time, the earliest time that you have to think about the future of your child? When is the earliest, you know, what your child will become, what will he do? When is the earliest? Many people reply, when he goes to college. Some people say that no, when he takes admission in school. Some people say, no, when he takes admission in kindergarten. No one has given me answer earlier than that. The Islamic way, the earliest that you can think about the future of your child is when you choose your life partner. When you choose your life partner is the time you think, what will you make your son? Because the mother, the father, the parents, they are the best teacher. You have to plan early. That's the earliest you have to think, or rather the latest that you have to think regarding the future of your child. I'd like to summarize the purpose of life and how a person should lead is, number one, that when you get education, see to it you get education in an institution, in a school, in a college, which caters to you for both the world, for akhirah and this world. Only the degrees of this world will not help you. Put him in a school which caters for both akhirah and this world both. And inshallah, we started with that philosophy of having Islamic International School, and if Allah wills, we want to expand more branches of such schools. Number two, they should see to it that they have friends which also have the same purpose of life. Their friends which are Islamic. When they grow up, they should join organization whose goal and objective is based on Quran and Sahih Hadith. Join Islamic organization, but before joining organization, check whether that organization is following the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the Quran and the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number four, when they choose their profession, Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 104, that let there arise out of you a band of people that enjoin people towards the good and forbid them from doing wrong. These are the ones that shall attain felicity. Allah says in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, وَمَنْ أَحَسَنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعِي لَلَّهِ وَعَمِلُ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنَّ لِمْنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness, and says that I'm a Muslim? Choose a profession that will take him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's no better profession than the profession of spending your time in spreading the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number five, see to it that you choose your life partner which has the same purpose, same goal. Allah and His Rasul. Allah centered. And the sixth point, I would like to end my talk by the verse of the Quran from Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 162, which says, Inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. All my prayers, my service of sacrifice, my life and my death are for the sake of Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Wa akhru dawana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir Naik, for your elucidative talk on such a significant topic, which many of us really don't think very much about, not really seriously. We would like to thank our audience, Jazakumullah Khaira, for being such a wonderful audience. With so much patience, you have carried on sitting. I would just request you, if there are elder people or ladies who might not be getting proper seat, kindly, I would request the youngsters to kindly make allowances for them, make adjustments for them. I know space is less, many people standing far off behind, some sitting on the ground, in the far off end of this ground, but I am certain you would be more accommodating.
Being inspired by Sheikh Ahmed Didad, when we started our foundation, Islam Research Foundation, it was not to become a speaker, it was to make a place to make speaker. You can't be a king, become a kingmaker. I could not become a speaker. So I started an organization to make speakers. Allah has his planning. The first speaker got cold feet. I was forced to go on the stage. And I realized that while I'm doing dawah with a non-Muslim, I don't stammer. When I speak with a Muslim, I stammer. When I speak with a non-Muslim, they don't stammer. When I'm on the stage, normally people stammer on the stage. Alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I went on the stage, I didn't stammer. He has his way. He made me from a doctor of a body to a doctor of a soul. And Sheikh Ahmed Didad, you know, asked him, uncle, in 1987 I met him the first time. You know, I was his driver, chauffeur. Wherever he used to go, I used to take him, because so I could spend more time with him. And uncle, why are you so aggressive? He told me, son, I'm not aggressive, I'm militant. You can fight the devil with two ways, holy water or fire. I chose the fire. That was his reply. And when I started my dawah, I used his material, but I was very soft. Very soft, very kind, no results. In the medical college, I started dawah. Then I became militant, more militant than Sheikh Didad. And wallah, what results I got. My Muslim friends used to run away. I was left alone with the non-Muslims. The results I got after being militant, then mashallah, Allah gave me hidayah. Coming more on the stage, I became soft. I became so soft that when the questioners abused me, I used to smile. So Sheikh Didad, then he gave me the title. First he gave me Didad Plus. Then when he saw me, son, they are abusing you, they are cursing you, and you are smiling. Then he gave me the title that, son, what you have, what took me 40 years to achieve, you have achieved it in 4 years. And alhamdulillah, you know, if you know my history, my background, I was a person who always wanted something best. I could never compromise for number two. Best. In childhood days, I remember, best electronics. Now, I have converted my desire to have best things in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to have the best of camera, best of equipment, state-of-the-art equipment, only to spread the message of Allah. I want to have the best conference. And that's why we have this conference. It was my desire, after seeing Grammy Awards and Oscar Awards, objective is haram, but I have to admire their science and technology. So we said, why can't we do the same for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The purpose is different. The purpose is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To show to the world that we Muslims also, alhamdulillah, all these things, not that without this we can't do dawah, but we want to show that even we want the best for the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we want the best office for ourselves, you know, we want best office in a house, Italian marble. I put Italian marble in my office in Islamic Research Foundation. There's no Italian marble in my house. Why? The place where people come to learn about Allah, I want to give them the best. At that time, when 1990s, Italian marble in India, Muslim office, unheard of. We started small. With only 20 to 25 square meter was my office. 25 square meter office. One employee. Now, mashallah, Allah's grace, we have more than 400 employees, mashallah. The largest Dawah organization, mashallah, Allah's help. And in school days, I was very good in debating. Very good. What was the purpose? Just to win the debate. Now I change my purpose. Trying to spread the deen. Deenul Haq. Got more results. First, I used to sleep only 5 hours, 6 hours, medical college. Now, sleep only 3 hours for sake of Allah. And I always had the philosophy of doing something unique or best in the world, one of the two. MashaAllah, started a unique channel, Peace TV, on comparative religion. Allah made it the most popular channel in the world. More than 100 million viewers, MashaAllah. After a couple of years, we launched a new channel, Peace TV Urdu. Last conference, we announced, inshallah, in June or July, we will launch a new channel, Peace TV Urdu, and Allah made it possible. This year, on 19th of June, we launched a new channel, Peace TV Urdu. Inshallah, in this conference. The last day of the conference. Inshallah, inshallah, if Allah wills. I would like to announce, we'll be launching a third channel, Peace TV Bangla. You know, because Bangla language, mashallah, a few hundred million people speak Bangla language. It's a requirement. My desire is to have Islamic channel in all the languages. But as for inshallah, in the next 8 or 9 months, before Ramadan, inshallah, next July 2010, inshallah, if Allah wills, if Allah helps, with Allah's help, we will launch the third channel, Peace TV Bangla, inshallah. We have several examples. You know, it was a desire that besides channel, have a place where people are trained for the purpose of life. And we started our school, Islamic International School. Purpose is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But while pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, realize Allah, inshallah, will give you in the hereafter and even in this world. With the same desire, I started the school saying, inshallah, every student of the school, an Islamic International School, we have more than 400 in Bombay and about 250 in Chennai, inshallah, all of them, inshallah, all of them will get 100 times more better teaching and surrounding than what Zakir Naik got. It is up to Allah whether he creates Zakir Naiks or multiple, but our desire is give them a base, give them a foundation where they can have 100 times better training, foundation, atmosphere than what Zakir Naik had. But it is in the hands of Allah whether he makes or not. And just to give you one more example of my son, Farik Naik. You know my son, mashallah, as I told you in my speech day for yesterday, I don't know Arabic as a language. I said I will teach my son Arabic, inshallah, lugha fasaha. And all the students of our school we taught, mashallah. My son, when the school started, mashallah, he got the best sports boy trophy. Not once, not twice, not three times, not four times, for 5 consecutive years. It made me happy. It made me happy. You know, because we used to think, you know, when I was in school, I used to admire. Coming out first, getting gold medal, that was my goal, you know. Youngster, though, coming out first in 100 meter dash. In school, I never got any medal. When I reached college, mashallah, I discovered that I was a long distance runner. and I got a gold medal in the medical college in 10 kilometers. But then I realized, gold medal, useless. Good. From far it looks good. What is a gold medal? 10 kilometers, people are pretty, nothing great. Ah, this is the man. And my focus changed. And that's how, mashallah, he told me that, son, I have done research and study in Christianity and Islam. You study other religions. Christianity is like everything on a platter. Sheikh Dida did the job so well, everything on a platter. It's a cakewalk. If you read Sheikh Dida's book, you can even debate the Pope. So then I studied Hinduism, Sikhism, Jainism, science, other subjects, and mashallah. As to admire the crowd that Sheikh Didat, the largest audience he addressed in Birmingham, 12,000 people. Mashallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mashallah. He opened up the pathways with his help. Mashallah, my son then became Hafizul Quran at the age of 13. Unique style. 1 year, 5 days a week. Unique. People said, Zakir is crazy. 1 hour every day, 5 days a week, 9 months a year, impossible. Most of the students in our school, within 2.5 to 4 years, they completed his. And one amongst them was my son. Then my son got black belt in Taekwondo. But what really pleased me was when he started giving lectures in public. At the age of 8, small lectures, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 50,000 people, 100,000 people before my talks. The first time I gave a lecture, public lecture, was the age of 27, 28. People used to tell me, oh, what a young person, 28 years used to feel. 28 years old. Sheikh Dida, 60, 70, 28 years, used to feel happy. My son, the first long public lecture of more than 1 hour 15 minutes with 119 quotations, 56 from the Quran, 52 from the Bible and 11 ahadith with Arabic at the age of only 14, half my age. That pleased me. MashaAllah, 1 hour 15 minutes, 119 quotations without any notes. And this year, MashaAllah, again he gave a lecture. Just last week, last Sunday he gave a lecture. This Sunday again he gave a lecture. First misconception of Islam, concept of God. Inshallah, inshallah, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he accept his efforts. And always tell, I tell my son, that Allah has given you the means. But see to it that make your requirement small. Make your requirement less. Why? Tomorrow you may not have this luxury. Your aim is to do dawah. As Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Fusila, chapter 41, verse number 33, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness, and says that I'm a Muslim? Why I say a da'i? I remember when I married my wife, I told her, I'm a doctor, I can promise you only 4,000 rupees a month. 4,000 rupees is less than $100. I can only promise you 4,000 rupees a month. If you want to marry me, marry me. And mashallah, she was a teacher in the college, earning much more than what I promised her. But she also wanted to die. Mashallah. So I tell my son, make your requirements less, so that if you're used to sleeping on the floor, if you're used to taking all the troubles, if you have to sacrifice and yet continue your dawah, it's easy. If you're used to luxury, and if the luxury is taken away from you, it will prevent you from continuing as a da'i. MashaAllah. I've seen to it that we have, my son has slept on the floor. He has been in 7-star hotels. And everything. Train the person from young. When he's young, he should be able to take the struggle of life. Don't give him a silver spoon in the mouth, which will be difficult for him to achieve the purpose of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I would like to end my talk by just summarizing. In order to achieve the purpose of your life, in different stages of your life, you have to see that you are towards the direction. Before I give these 6 points, when people take admission in our school, I normally ask them, when is the best time, the earliest time that you have to think about the future of your child? When is the earliest, you know, what your child will become, what will he do, when is the earliest? Many people reply, when he goes to college. Some people say that no, when he takes admission in school. Some people say, no, when he takes admission in kindergarten. No one has given me answer earlier than that. The Islamic way, the earliest that you can think about the future of your child is when you choose your life partner. When you choose your life partner is the time you think, what will you make your son? Because the mother, the father, the parents, they are the best teacher. You have to plan early. That's the earliest you have to think, or rather the latest that you have to think regarding the future of your child. I'd like to summarize the purpose of life and how a person should lead is, number one, that when you get education, see to it you get education in an institution, in a school, in a college, which caters to you for both the world, for Akhirah and this world. Only the degrees of this world will not help you. Put him in a school which caters for both Akhirah and this world both. And inshallah, we started with that philosophy of having Islamic International School, and if Allah wills, we want to expand more branches of such schools. Number two, they should see to it that they have friends which also have the same purpose of life. They have friends which are Islamic. When they grow up, they should join organization whose goal and objective is based on Quran and Sahih Hadith. Join Islamic organization, but before joining organization, check whether that organization is following the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the Quran and the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number four, when they choose their profession, Allah says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse 104, that let there arise out of you a band of people that enjoin people towards the good and forbid them from doing wrong. These are the ones that shall attain felicity. Allah says in Surah Fusilat, chapter number 41, verse number 33, وَمَنْ أَحَسَنُ قَالَ مِمَّنْ دَعِلَ اللَّهِ وَعَمِلُ صَالِحًا قَالَ إِنَّ الْإِمْنُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Who is better in speech than one who invites to the way of thy Lord, works righteousness, and says that I'm a Muslim? Choose a profession that will take him closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's no better profession than the profession of spending your time in spreading the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number five, see to it that you choose your life partner which has the same purpose, same goal. Allah and His Rasul. Allah centered. And the sixth point, I would like to end my talk by the verse of the Quran from Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 162, which says, Inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. All my prayers, my service of sacrifice, my life and my death are for the sake of Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Jazakallah khair, Dr. Zakir Naik, for your elucidative talk on such a significant topic which many of us really don't think very much about, not really seriously. We would like to thank our audience, Jazakumullah Khaira, for being such a wonderful audience. With so much patience, you have carried on sitting. I would just request you, if there are elder people or ladies who might not be getting proper seat, kindly, I would request the youngsters to kindly make allowances for them, make adjustments for them. I know space is less, many people standing far off behind, some sitting on the ground. in the far off end of this ground, but I am certain you'd be more accommodating. We begin with the question and answer session, and to get more out of this session in the limited time available, I would request you to kindly follow the rules very, very strictly. Your question should be on the topic, what is the purpose of our life only? For non-Muslims, we may allow questions which are away from the topic but on Islam and comparative religion, as some of them may not have had adequate time yesterday during the open session. Second point, your question should be brief and to the point. You may ask only one question at a time. Three mics have been provided in this vast ground, one in the front on my left for the gents, mic number two for the gents in the rear section, and one mic for the ladies in front of the ladies section. You may kindly queue at the mics to put forward your question. Non-Muslims will be given first preference to ask questions. Volunteers at the mic are requested to kindly ensure the same. Kindly state your name and profession before you put forward your question. We start with the ladies section. Can we have a first question from the ladies mic, please? Yes, sister.
Hello. Assalamu alaikum. मेरा नाम रेशमा भाग्यलक्ष्मी है. मैं एक हिंदू हूँ. अब मैं इस्लाम में चलना चाह रहा हूँ.
Excuse me, before the Zakir answers, I am told instead of three, there are five mics arranged because of the huge audience present here. First, second and third mics for the gent, and two mics in the ladies section, mic number one, mic number two. So we'll allow the second question on the ladies mic and we'll continue in a circular fashion. Yes, Dr. Zakir.
The sister said that she's a Hindu, but she wants to accept Islam. Behen, main aapse puchna chahta hoon ki aap इस्लाम दिल से कबूल करना चाहती है?
हाँ.
कोई आप पे जबरदस्ती कर रहा है?
कोई भी जबरदस्ती नहीं है, मेरी मर्जी से मैं आया हूँ.
माशाल्लाह. I'm asking the sister, does she want to accept Islam out of the free will, and she has said yes. क्या आप मानते हैं कि खुदा एक है?
हाँ जी.
और आप मानते हैं कि मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम उसके आखिरी पैगंबर है?
हाँ.
मानते?
हाँ हाँ.
तो मैं इंशाल्लाह आपको कलमा पढ़ाऊंगा, आप अरबी में दोहराइए, बाद में उसका तर्जुमा करूंगा.
अच्छी बात है.
अशहदु
अल्लाह
अल्लाह
इलाहा
इलाहा इल्लल्लाह
इल्लल्लाह
व अशहदु
अशहदु
अन्ना
अन्ना
मोहम्मदन
मोहम्मदन
अब्दुहु
अब्दुहु
व रसूलुहु
व रसूलुहु.
मैं गवाही देती हूँ.
अच्छी बात.
मैं गवाही देती हूँ
के
अल्लाह के अलावा
कोई माबूद
नहीं है
और मोहम्मद
सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम
उसके
बंदे और पैगंबर है. माशाल्लाह, आप मुसलमान हो चुके हैं. अल्लाह आपको जज़ाए खैर दे और अल्लाह आपको जन्नत नसीब करवे. आई प्रे टू अल्लाह सुब्हानहू व तआला दैट मे ही ग्रांट जन्ना एंड इंशाअल्लाह वी प्रे टू अल्लाह सुब्हानहू व तआला दैट मे यू लीड अ पीसफुल लाइफ सो दैट यू अटेन ऑल द थ्री. दैट्स द प्लेजर ऑफ अल्लाह, पीस इन दिस वर्ल्ड एंड पैराडाइस इन द हियर आफ्टर इंशाअल्लाह.
मेरा नाम है कुछ भी.
Can we have the mic number one on, please, for the ladies?
मेरे को एक नाम रख चाहिए. नाम रखना.
Sister has asked that she wants to suggest a name for herself. आप अपना नाम आयशा रख सकते हैं. आयशा.
अच्छा.
Mic number two in the rear section of the ladies, please.
Hello. Good evening, sir. My name is Ruby Parker and I'm a dress designer. I want to, this is a question on behalf of my friend. She is a Muslim and she is married to a Hindu. Okay, but she follows Islam and the husband follows the Hindu religion. And she and her family, they are not comfortable regarding she married to a Hindu. Now, can you put some light on this? Because she is very confused of what to do. She is madly in love with that man.
If I understood your question, sister, you said that there is a Muslim girl who is married a Hindu boy and she is madly in love. What she should, is this the question, sister?
Right.
She said that... No, you said that... has she got married or not?
Yes, she is.
Sister said
court
that,
marriage.
Court marriage. Sister said that there's a Muslim girl who's married a Hindu boy, she's madly in love, court marriage, what should she do? The thing is there that Quran says in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2, verse number 221, it says that do not marry a mushrika, do not marry an idolatress until she believes. A believing woman, even if she's a bondswoman, she's much better than an unbelieving woman even if she adores you. The verse continues that do not marry a mushrik man, do not marry an idolatering man, even if he allows you, until he believes. A believing man, even if he's a bondsman, even if he's a slave man, he's far better than a mushrik man, an unbelieving man, even if he allows you. So in Islam, a Muslim girl cannot marry a non-Muslim man. And as I told earlier, the reason is that if you have a vehicle, one tire of the vehicle is of a cycle, of a bicycle, and the other tire, it is of a truck. But naturally, the vehicle will not run. And furthermore, every girl, every human being would want that their spouse also go to Jannah. So if she claims to be a Muslim, her main purpose of life is to please Allah and His Rasul. And as I told you, the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4, 48, Surah Nisa chapter 4, 116, that Allah will forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk, associating partners with God, He will never forgive. So how can she have a life partner whose purpose of life is different? That means maybe you are selfish. You want to go to Jannah, but you don't want your life partner to go to Jannah. So surely, if she really loves the husband, she should put an ultimatum that if you continue, you will not go to Jannah. So put an ultimatum that if you want me, you will also get Jannah by accepting Islam. If you accept Islam, I am with you. Otherwise, I am not with you. So that she gets the boast of this world and he also gets the boast of this world. Best of both the world.
Number one in the front.
My name is Prem. Full name is Prem Mishra, and I'm a non-Muslim. And my question is like question with you, sir. I want to accept Islam. It's my own questions. It's not in love or something. It's my own questions. By professionally, I want to accept the Islam, but become a true means like how to what's the true Muslim guys or something. So that's why I just want to know that.
Brother, if I heard your question correctly, you want to accept Islam and you want to know what is a true Muslim?
Yes, how to become a true Muslim.
How to become a true Muslim?
Yeah.
Brother, to become a true Muslim, Muslim means a person who submits his will to God. So if you submit your will to God, you become a Muslim. Submitting your will to God means first you have to agree there is one God and there's no one worthy of worship besides Allah. Then you have to believe Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger, and then if you read the Quran, as I mentioned in my talk, it is the last and final instruction manual for the human being. So if you read the Quran and implement on the Quran and follow the guidance Allah has given you and abstain from things which is prohibited, then you become a true practicing Muslim.
Yes, sir. And one more. Does I have to change my total identity? Like as a...
My name,
I'm a non-Muslim, so that's why.
Is it compulsory? Is asking to change my name? Is it compulsory to change your name if you become a Muslim? No.
It's not compulsory. If you want, you can. So changing the name is not compulsory. Unless your name involves shirk. If your name does not involve any shirk, any idol worship, etc., it's perfectly fine. Okay. Otherwise, you can continue with your old name or you can adopt a new name. But if you are proud to be a Muslim, I would advise that you adopt a Muslim name so people will recognize you. Like how if you become a doctor, you put a cross sign to tell people, you know, you're a doctor. So similarly, it's not compulsory you should change your name, but if you change, it's preferable, people will know that you're a Muslim. So now my question to you is, that would you like to accept Islam now? Would you like to accept Islam?
Yes, sir.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe that idol worship is prohibited?
Yeah.
Do you believe that idol worship is wrong?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger?
Yes, sir.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
Is
anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No, sir. No, definitely not.
Is there any economic pressure?
No, sir.
Is there any physical pressure?
No.
Because forcing anyone to accept Islam is prohibited in Islam. No one can force anyone to become a Muslim. Besides being prohibited in Islam, it is also prohibited in this country. Even in India, it is prohibited to force anyone to adopt any religion without his free will. But if you want to accept Islam, no one can prevent you, and even the country cannot prevent you. So if you want to accept Islam, I will say in Arabic and you repeat it, brother, okay?
Okay, sir.
Ashadu. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness.
Can you repeat?
I bear witness. I bear witness.
I beg release.
That
there is
no God.
No God.
But Allah.
And
Prophet Muhammad.
Prophet Muhammad.
Peace be upon him.
Peace be upon him.
Is the servant. And messenger. Of Allah. MashaAllah, you're a Muslim brother.
Thank you, Lord.
I would request that if you can come on the stage and take a copy of the Quran, so that you can be a better practicing Muslim. I'd like to give a translation of the copy of the Quran. I'd request a volunteer if they can give some copies of the Quran here. Brother, can you come on the stage, please? I'd like to give you a translation of the copy of the Quran so that it will help you to become a better practicing Muslim. Jazakallah, and we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may He accept your efforts and may He grant you Jannah, inshallah.
The next question from Mike 2 in the middle of the Jan section. Yes, brother.
Abhi, Dr. Jagin Nayak Ushe Vidal Ake Bhashan Kiya Jitna Admi Idar Ye Bhashan Sunne Ke Liye Aya Quran को सबको मैं अल्लाह से प्रार्थना करता है कि ये लोग का संसार बाल बच्चे सुखी रहो। God came here to earth for good protection only. Jackie Lucian came here for good protection only. अच्छा अभी मैं मेरा नाम नारायण वेंकटेश अय्यर धारावी में रहता है। मैं हिंदू है लेकिन मैं कुरान को मानता है मैं बाइबल को मानता है मैं गीता को मानता है आई लुक इक्वल फॉर ऑल लेकिन मैं डॉक्टर साहब को ये पूछना चाहता है शेख सैयद मुल्ला पठान क्यों रखा ब्राह्मण क्षत्रिय चंडाल शूद्र क्यों रखा इसको आंसर अभी चाहिए
द ब्रदर बिफोर आस्किंग हिज क्वेश्चन ही सेड that he says that there are lakhs, hundreds of thousands of people gathered here and he wishes that peace be on all these people. Then he said that Dr. Zakir Naik has come here to give good message and he's asking the question that he's a Hindu but He has read and he believes in the Quran, he believes in the Bible, he believes in the Veda, and he is asking that why are there Pathan, Sheikh, Mullah, Brahmin, Kshatriya, etc. As far as the question is concerned, why are there Pathan, Sheikh, Mullah? These are family names. Nowhere, just because a person is a Sheikh or a Mullah or a Pathan does not make him superior to any other human being. The Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13, Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min zakrin wa unsa wa jalnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila litarafu inna akramakum indallahi atqakum inna allaha alimun khabir. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female, and have divided you into nations and tribes so that you shall recognize each other, not that you shall despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the person who has taqwa. The criteria for judgment in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not sex, it's not caste, it's not color, it's not age, it's not wealth, it is taqwa. It is God consciousness, it is piety. Just because a person is born in a mullah family or a khan family or a sheikh family will not take into Jannah, but taqwa, piety, righteous deed, God consciousness will take into Jannah. But this is the Islamic concept. In the concept of Hinduism, the Vedas say Almighty God created from the head the Brahmins, from the chest Kshatriya. Brahmin are the learned class, Kshatriya are the warrior class. God from his abdomen or his thighs created the Vaishyas, that is the business class, and from the feet the Shudras, that is the servant class, that is the slave. This is the concept of Veda. In Islam, no human being is superior or inferior because of birth. There's no caste system in Islam. It is there in Hinduism. And for more details why this is, you can refer to my video cassette, Similarities Between Islam and Islam and Hinduism. Now coming to your question, first part, you said that you believe in Quran, you believe in Bible, you believe in Veda. I request the people, at least believe that one book is 100% the word of God. Not two, three, four, at least one book. So the Christian will say, I believe Bible is 100% the word of God. The Hindu will say, I believe the Veda to be 100% the word of God. The Muslim will say, I believe that Quran is 100% the word of God. You, mashallah, believe in all three. Now, do you know there are many contradictory things in the Quran and the Bible and the Veda? Let's not discuss that. I'm asking you today, at least follow what is common. At least what is common in the Veda, Bible and Quran, which you believe, at least follow that. All these three scriptures say that God is one. He has got no image. He has got no idol. He has got no picture. It's mentioned in the Bible, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 6, verse number 4. Moses, peace be upon him, says, Shema Israelo, adna hezo adna echad, Hear, O Israel, the Lord, our God, is one Lord. If you read the Hindu scriptures, it's mentioned in Chandogya Upanishad, chapter number 6, section number 2, verse number 1, Ikkam Ividityam, God is only one without a second. It's mentioned in the Svetasita Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, and Yajurveda, chapter number 32, verse number 3, Na tasya pratima asti, of that God, there is no pratima. Pratima in Sanskrit means an image, a photograph, a painting, a picture, a portrait, a sculpture, an idol. Of that God, there is no pratima. Of that God, there is no image. Of that God, there is no photograph. There is no picture. There is no portrait. There is no painting. There is no sculpture. There is no idol. There is no statue. Quran says the same in Surah Ikhlas, chapter number 112, verse number 1 to 4. Qul wallahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. Say there is God one and only, the absolute, the eternal. He begets not, nor is he begotten, and there is nothing like him. I am asking the question, do you believe in one God, brother? Do you believe in one God? Kya aap ek Bhagwan mein mante?
Main abhi tak Bhagwan ek hi hai manta hai.
Aap Budh parasti mein mante?
Brahma satyam jagan mitya jeevo Brahma eva na paraha.
Aap Budh parasti?
Jeevan muktastu tak jeeva.
Bhai sahab, aap Budh parasti mein?
Atma gaya to kuch nahi.
Aap Budh parasti?
Shari ek hi hai.
आप बुद्ध परिस्थिति में मानते?
अब नहीं, इतना नहीं।
बुद्ध परिस्थिति में मानते?
नहीं, उसको क्या है?
बुद्ध परिस्थिति
मुझे ये चीज नहीं मानता है।
माशाल्लाह, माशाल्लाह।
मैं रूप रेख नहीं मानता है।
ब्रदर बिलीव इन वन गॉड, डज नॉट बिलीव इन आइडोलेशन।
एक अल्लाह बोले तो, आप बोले तो पाप जाता है, ला बोले तो पाप को आने के देता नहीं, उसका नाम अल्लाह है।
ये आपका डेफिनेशन है, ये पूरा डेफिनेशन नहीं है।
ला बोले तो पाप जाता है, माँ बोले तो पाप को आने के देता नहीं, उसका नाम राम है। राम बोले तो आदमी नहीं है, आदमी रूपरेख नहीं है, रूपरेख मानने वाला गार नहीं है। गार ओनली बिलीव, विश्वास, एक सत्य, एक प्रमाण में चलने वाला को गार एक संतोष देता है। आप वन काइंड ऑफ यूर ए गार, डॉक्टर जाति वन काइंड ऑफ गार, वो बुलाए तो इतना आदमी आया, लेकिन वो गार।
आप जो भाई साहब बोल रहे हैं, आपके वेद में लिखा है ऋग्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 1 वर्स नंबर 164, हिम्न नंबर 164 वर्स नंबर 46, एकम सत विप्र बहुधा विदान्ते, गॉड इज वन, ट्रुथ इज वन, बट सेजेस कॉल हिम ए वैरायटी ऑफ नेम। आपने कहा कि डॉक्टर जाकिर नायक गॉड है, डॉक्टर जाकिर नायक गॉड नहीं है और हो भी नहीं सकता हूं। मैं गॉड का क्रिएशन हूं, मैं अल्लाह का बंदा हूं, मैं अब्दुल्ला हूं, अल्लाह नहीं हूं। क्योंकि आपने मुझे गॉड कहा, इसीलिए मैं गॉड थोड़ी बन जाता हूं। आपके साथ आप मुझे भी घसीट रहे जहन्नम में। मैं अल्लाह नहीं हूं, अब्दुल्ला हूं, अल्लाह का बंदा हूं। उसी तरीके से कोई भी इंसान अल्लाह नहीं हो सकता, वो भगवान नहीं हो सकता, ईश्वर नहीं हो सकता। इसी तरीके से राम, राम एक अच्छे मनुष्य थे। आप अगर कहते हैं कि वो अवतार है, अवतार के मानी है अवत्र, मतलब खुदा ने भेजा, लेकिन खुदा नहीं, खुदा ने भेजा। तो आप अगर कहते हैं, इफ यू से दैट राम इज एन अवतार, अव अंतर मीन्स सेंट फ्रॉम ऑलमाइटी गॉड, इफ यू से दैट आई गॉट नो ऑब्जेक्शन। इफ यू से राम इज अ मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड, मे बी ही इज, मे बी इज नॉट, बिकॉज आवर बिलव्ड प्रॉफेट मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम सेड देयर वर 124,000 मैसेंजर्स सेंट ऑन द फेस ऑफ द अर्थ, बाय नेम ओनली 25 आर मेंशन्ड इन द कुरान। राम मे बी अ मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड, मे बी इज, मे बी इज नॉट, आई कैन नॉट से फॉर श्योर। बट इवन इफ राम वॉज अ मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड, इवन इफ कृष्णा वॉज अ मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड, ही वॉज सेंट ओनली फॉर दोज पीपल एंड फॉर दैट टाइम। टूडे ऑल द ह्यूमन बींग्स, वेदर दे लिव इन इंडिया, वेदर अमेरिका, वेदर कैनेडा, वेदर यूके, वेदर सऊदी अरेबिया, दे शुड फॉलो द लास्ट एंड फाइनल मैसेंजर प्रॉफेट मोहम्मद पीस बी अपॉन हिम। आई एम नॉट सेइंग दिस, इट इज योर स्क्रिप्चर। अगर आप पढ़ेंगे आपकी किताब भविष्य पुराना पर्व 3 खंड 3 अद्वैत 3 श्लोकास 5-8, भविष्य पुराना पर्व 3 खंड 3 अद्वैत 3 श्लोकास 10-27 स्पीक अबाउट प्रॉफेट मोहम्मद पीस बी अपॉन हिम। इफ अथर्ववेद बुक नंबर 20 हिम नंबर 127 वर्स नंबर 1-14, अथर्ववेद बुक नंबर 20 हिम नंबर 21 वर्स नंबर 6, अथर्ववेद बुक नंबर 20 हिम नंबर 21 वर्स नंबर 7, ऋग्वेद बुक नंबर 1 हिम नंबर 53 वर्स नंबर 9 स्पीक अबाउट प्रॉफेट मोहम्मद पीस बी अपॉन हिम। ही इज मेंशन एज अहमद, अहमद मींस वन हु इज वर्थ प्रेजिंग, वन हु प्रेजेस इज कॉल्ड एज अहमद। He is mentioned as Ahmad. If you read in Sam Ved, Uttar Chik, mantra number 1500, in Sam Ved, Indra, chapter number 2, hymn number 152, in Yajurved, chapter number 31, verse number 8, in Rig Ved, book number 8, hymn number 6, mantra number 10, in Atharva Ved, book number 8, hymn number 5, mantra number 16, Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14, he is mentioned as Ahmad. He is mentioned as Narashansa. Nara Shansa means, Nar means man, Shansa means praise, a man who's praiseworthy. If you translate into Arabic, it is Muhammad. He is mentioned by name Muhammad as Nara Shansa in several places. In Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 13, mantra number 3, Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 18, mantra number 9, Rig Ved, book number 1, mantra number, hymn number 106, mantra number 4, Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 142, mantra number 3, Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 3, mantra number 2, Rig Ved, book number 5, mantra number 5, मंत्र नंबर टू ऋग्वेद बुक नंबर सेवन हिम नंबर टू मंत्र नंबर टू यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 20 वर्स 37 यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 20 वर्स 57 यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 21 वर्स नंबर 31 यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 21 वर्स नंबर 57 यजुर्वेद 28 वर्स नंबर 42 यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 20 वर्स नंबर 19 यजुर्वेद चैप्टर नंबर 22 वर्स नंबर 42 आई कैन कीप ऑन गोइंग ओनली गिविंग रेफरेंसेज फ्रॉम द हिंदू स्क्रिप्चर अबाउट द लास्ट एंड फाइनल मैसेंजर प्रॉफेट मोहम्मद पीस बी अपॉन हिम ही इज आल्सो प्रोफेसाइज इन कल्कि पुराना एज कल्कि अवतार That his mother's name will be Sumati, that's Amina. His father's name will be Vishnu Yash, that's Abdullah. He'll be born in a place of peace, Sambala, that is Makkah. He'll be born in the family of the chief of the village of Sambala, that is chief of Makkah, that is Quraysh. He'll have four companions, talking Khulafa Rashidin. On and on, if you really believe in your scriptures, you have to follow and believe in the last and final messenger prophet Muhammad peace be upon him. Do you believe in prophet Muhammad peace be upon him? Kya aap Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mein mante?
Main manta hai.
Ke wo paigambar hai.
Main paigambar ko manta hai.
Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam paigambar hai mante?
Paigambar manta hai. Paigambar one kind of God. क्यों वो
वन काइंड ऑफ गॉड ने वन काइंड ऑफ मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड गॉड बोले तो गलत है गॉड बोले तो गलत है मैसेंजर ऑफ गॉड बोलिए
मैं 2,63,00,000 राम 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 लिखा लेकिन अभी तक राम मेरे पास आया नहीं क्यों
बराबर द ब्रदर सेड ही रोड 20 मिलियन टाइम्स राम 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 बट राम हैजंट कम टू हिम येट सो देयरफॉर आई एम टेलिंग यू बिलीव in one and only creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believe in all his messengers as well as the last and final messenger prophet Muhammad peace be upon him hope that answers the question
in the next question from mic number 3 in the rare section gents
hey
yes brother
good evening sir I thank you for the word that a purpose of life which is given today and you have given the surahs and the ayat from the Quran Surah 17:88 says, if all mankind and the jinn would come together to produce the like of this Quran, they could not produce it. But History of Al-Tabari, Volume 6, page 107, Ibn Shahad, Kitab Al-Tabkat, Al-Kabir, Volume 1, parts 1 and 2, pages 236 and 239, Ibn Ishaq, Sirat Rasulullah, Page number 165-167 says that Muhammad was inspired by the Satan and spoken on behalf of three gods, goddess, Allahat, Al-Uzza and Mannat, saying that their intercession is hoped for. After some time, later upon receiving further revelation from angel Jibril, that those verses were not from Allah, but inspired by Satan. My question is, this incident has several implications. The challenges of the Quran to bring the surah like it in Surah 17:88 was actually met by those satanic words in Muhammad's own time, right? Which in turn leads to the conclusion that the rest of the Quran, is this from Allah either?
The brother asked the question.
Name, can we have your name and profession,
please? What's your name?
I'm Danny. I'm student. I'm studying on the book.
Brother Danny has asked a very good question.
Yes, sir.
That he quoted Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse number 88, that says that if all the men and jinn got together to produce the like of the Quran, they will not be able to do it. That's also repeated in Surah Thur, chapter number 52, verse number 34. Just to help you out. And I'll give you more references. But he said, quoting Tabari and etc., that this verse of the Quran was from Satan. Maybe you read it wrong. It was an allegation that people said, this words of the Quran is from Satan, and immediately the revelation came. Of Surah Waqia, chapter 56, verse number 77-80, saying that this book is well preserved. Who none shall touch except those who are pure. A book well guarded. by the Lord of the worlds. This verse came to say that no one be able to touch the Quran in Lohe Mehfooz, in tablet well preserved, except the Mutahareen, that is the pure angels, indicating that the Satans can come close nowhere to the Quran. So this was an allegation laid by the mushriks of Makkah on the Prophet that this is a Satan handiwork. In reply to this, there are various verses. Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 82, Quran says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبُّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ قَانَ مِنْ إِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوْجَدُوا فِي اِكْتِلَافٍ كَثِيرًا. Do they not consider the Quran with K? Had it been from anyone besides Allah, there'd have been many contradictions. Besides this, please let me reply, brother.
Yeah.
Besides this, what you mentioned, Allah gives a challenge that if you say it's from Satan, in Surah Tur chapter 52, verse number 34, and Surah Isra chapter 17 verse 18, which you quote, that if all the men and the jinns got together, they would not be able to produce the like of the Quran. Then Allah makes the challenge easier. Allah says in Surah Hud chapter number 11 verse number 13, I am giving you more material to attack. Allah says in Surah Hud chapter number 13 verse chapter number 11 verse number 13, if all the men and the jinns got together, they will not be able to produce 10 surahs like the Quran. Allah makes the challenge easier. Brother, do you want to listen to the answer or not?
Yeah, go ahead, please. Sorry. Please go ahead.
You are
later on, actually, I just wanted to add.
This is not a debate time.
No, sir.
It's a question answer time. You finish your question, your question is over. Now listen to my answer.
Sir, should I add it? Then you give an answer that will be easy for me to understand.
But why didn't you add it in the first place?
Because it's now you're telling something, then I have to add it.
So then you go behind the queue and then add. No problem. Go behind the queue and add.
No, because there were many verses which was saying that.
I'm helping you.
Okay. Sorry, sir. But please go ahead.
Furthermore, it's mentioned Allah makes the challenge easier. Allah says in Surah Yunus, chapter number 10, verse number 38, that if all the men and jinn got together, they will not be able to produce a surah like the Quran. Allah makes it much more easier in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 23 and 24. Allah says that wa in kuntum fi raybin mimma nazzalna 'abdana fa'tu bi suratin min misli, and if you are in doubt as what we have produced to our servant Prophet Muhammad from time to time, produce a surah somewhat similar, min misli, not exactly, somewhat similar, min misli, wad ushwada akum min dunillah in kuntum sadiqin, and call forth your helpers and witnesses if there are besides Allah, if your doubts are but true, fa illam tafalu, but if you cannot, walan tafalu, and of a surety you cannot, fattaqun nar allati waqudu annasa wal ijara uddatil kafirin, then fear the fuel whose men is fire and stone. Fear the fire whose fuel is men and stone, which is prepared for those who reject faith. This is a challenge. It's a stunning challenge. Many people tried to produce a surah like the Quran, but they have failed miserably. The language of the Quran is so divine, is so pure. Not that people didn't try. When the Quran was revealed, Arabic was at its peak. It was at its peak. The Arabs, they were proud of the language. Allah says, with your language I have produced the Quran, try and produce a single surah, somewhat similar, not exactly. And some surahs of the Quran, one surah is hardly 3 verses, hardly 10 words only. Many people tried, they failed miserably. If you think this is anyone besides Allah, you try and produce a surah. That's a challenge. No one has done it, neither can you do it. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. May I make a point clear? We cannot allow one questioner to dominate the whole lecture series in the question or debate session, but anyone who's interested in a long discussion, this is not the time, because we have just 10-15 minutes left for the question answer session. I would request you to kindly frame your question briefly. If it goes more than 4 to 5 sentences, we'll disallow that question and allow the next questioner to put forward the question. Dr. Zakir has a background of this kind of question, and most of the questions which come forward, assume he knows the background, just put forward your question directly to him. Don't give the background. Assume he knows the background and put your question. Yes, sister, mic number 4.
Good evening, sir. My name is Sabina. I'm a student. You You gave an example about how we students, the youngsters, shoot an arrow and draw a bullseye. I would just like to make the same sort of allegation to you. You shot an arrow, your arrow, and drew your bullseye. And now if anybody does not aim where you have aimed before, they are wrong. That I think is inconsiderate and inhuman.
Sisters asked a very important question. When I gave the example, people shoot in the air and then draw the bullseye. She's saying and alleging, even I have done the same. And if people don't agree, then I don't agree with them. Sister, please tell me, where was my arrow wrong? Which part of my lecture was putting a, I gave example that people do graduation. Why do graduation? I don't know. What you will do? I don't know. After passing, what job you will take? I don't know. I gave example. Now you, sister, give me an example in my lecture. Which part of my lecture was shooting the air, shooting the arrow in the air and drawing a bullseye? If not, then I would tell you that you are shooting in the air and then drawing the bullseye.
But you already said it.
Sister, which part of my lecture? I give you a chance to reply. Which part of my lecture was shooting in the air and then drawing a bullseye?
Your part of the lecture was not shooting in the air.
MashaAllah, thank you very much.
The whole A was like the why judging people by defining them on the terms of Islamic and what their purpose in life is only in terms of Islamic.
You give me a better purpose of life. You
why
give
I
me
give
a better
any...
purpose. If see, we are having open question and session, anyone can differ with me. I'm not
exactly,
telling I'm always
people
right.
People differ from you. You
have the right to differ. But when you differ, you have to give the reason. For example, I say 2 plus 3 is equal to 4. You say, no, it is not 4, it is 5. I'll ask you why. So tell me which part of my lecture, or you tell me, is there any better purpose of life than to thank the Creator, than to worship Him?
There are differences, and you cannot just, you know, convert everyone, convert not in the sense of converting into Islam, converting people's viewpoints. You know, there are differences.
Sister, you are not answering my question. You are beating around the bush.
I'm not
my question
around the
is,
bush.
What is
That's
the
because
purpose?
Because you're presuming that you, I will answer whatever you want me to answer.
No, sister.
I'll answer it in my way.
So you're always beating around the bush.
I've heard his answer. Why should I
listen to it? So thank you, sister. Thank you for your comments. And we leave the audience to be the judge. How many people will follow you? How many people follow
I
me?
Don't want followers.
We'll come to know later on. So next time when you give a lecture, I hope you get an audience which is big. So then they listen to your answer of purpose of creation, sister.
Sir, in the rear.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. My name is Rashmi Singh. मैं आपसे ये बोलना चाहती हूँ कि मैंने इस्लाम दिल से कबूल कर लिया, पर मैं चाहती हूँ कि मैं आप मुझे कलमा पढ़ाएं.
Sister said that she wants to accept Islam and she wants me to make her read the Shahada. Do you understand English, sister?
Yes.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe that idol worship is wrong?
Yes.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the final messenger of God?
Yes.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No.
Is there any economic pressure?
No.
Is there any physical pressure?
No.
Are you accepting with your free will?
Yes.
Yes, sister. So I will inshallah recite the kalma in Arabic and you can repeat it. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness
that
there is no God
but Allah
and Prophet Muhammad
peace be upon him
is his servant and messenger. MashaAllah, sister, now you are a Muslim and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he guide you and may he keep you on the straight path, as Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al Imran chapter 3 verse number 8. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. That, oh Lord, please keep us,
Please keep us on the straight path after thou hast guided us and opened the heart. Keep us on the straight path. So I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may He give you more hidayah to keep you in the straight path and may He grant you Jannah.
Sir, I want to ask you one question. Sir, agar mere ghar pe mere parents ko is baare mein pata chalta hai, to how can I, main unko samjhau kaise ki main jo kar rahi hu sahi hai?
He starts a question that if the parents come to know at home, how will she convince the parents that what she's doing is the truth? Sister, first thing is that you start loving your parents more, number one. Start loving your mother and father more, obey them, respect them, follow them, unless if they tell you something against Allah and His Rasul, that's the only time you disobey. There should be a difference between what you were before and what you are now. Maybe you never used to follow many of the advice. Now, as long as what they say doesn't go against Quran and Sahih Hadith, my request to you is, even if you don't like it, you start following. They should see a difference. This is my daughter before she was a Muslim, and now this is my daughter after she accepted Islam. If they find a change in you, they will start asking you, yesterday you weren't following me, now you're following everything what I'm saying. Immediately. Why? This is what the Quran says. This is what our beloved Prophet said, that paradise lies beneath the feet of your mother. In this way, you try and win them over. The Quran says in Surah Futilah, chapter number 41, verse number 34, that it is better to win over them, and it can be done with hikmah. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikma wal mawazatil hasna wajadun billati ahsan. Invite all to the way of thy Lord with wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in ways that are best and most gracious. I would request you to give my DVD Similarities Between Islam and Hinduism to your parents, and inshallah it will soften their heart. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may give hidayah to your parents also and to your family members.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, brother. Mic number one in the front.
Dr. Jakir Naik, sir, मैं तहे दिल से आपको नमस्ते कहता हूँ. मेरा नाम यीशु दास है. तो मेरा प्रश्न इस तरह से है कि इस्लाम कितनी शादी करने का इजाजत देता है और क्यों?
Brother asked the question that how many marriages are permitted in Islam and why, referring to the polygamy.
मतलब मैं जानना चाहता हूँ कि कुरान के अनुसार में सही में कितना होना चाहिए और कितना नहीं होना चाहिए.
According to the Quran, how many marriages can you do? As far as the woman is concerned, according to Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 20 to 24, a married woman cannot marry again, so women should have only one husband maximum. As far as the other is concerned, Quran says in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 3, marry women for choice in twos, threes or fours, but if you can't do justice, marry only one. You can marry two, three or four, but if you can't do justice, marry only one. This statement, marry only one if you can't do justice, is only given in the Quran. There is no other scripture on the face of the earth which says marry only one besides the Quran. If you read the Ramayana, if you read the Mahabharata, you can marry as many wives as you want. If you know, if you read Ramayana, the father of Ram, how many wives he had? He had more than one wife. Krishna, if you read Mahabharata, how many wives he had? Two, four, 10,000, 16,108 wives. So when Krishna can have 16,108 wives, so why can't we Muslims have up to four? If you read the Bible, in the Old Testament as the New Testament, you can marry as many wives as you wish. Solomon had 700 wives. Abraham had 3 wives according to the Bible. It is the church which put up a limit. Christians should marry only one. It is Rabbi Ben Shimgan Houda who passed a synod that Jews should marry only one. In India, it is the Indian Penal Code in 1954 which passed a law in Hindu Marriage Act which said that Hindu should marry only one. It is the Indian Penal Code, not the Hindu scripture, which says that Hindu should have only one wife. Let's analyze what are the reasons that Islam gives permission for a man to have more than one wife. Marrying more than one wife is not compulsory in Islam, it's optional.
But if you marry more than one wife, you should do justice between your wives. The logical reason we can think that Islam has given permission is that male and female are born in equal proportion. But if you ask any medical doctor, any pediatrician, he will tell you that the child, the girl, the female child is a stronger sex medically as compared to the male child. She can fight the germs and diseases much better than a male child. So more female children are alive as compared to male children. As life goes on, there is death due to war, due to accident, due to cigarette smoking, due to alcohol. In all these cases, more male are dying as compared to female. So today in the world, there are more females in the world as compared to males. In few third world countries like India, etc., where the female population is less than the male population because of female infanticide and female feticide. Every year in India, more than 1 million fetuses are being aborted after they identified that they are females. If this evil practice stops, even in India, the male population will become less than the female population. In New York alone, there are 7.8. In New York alone, there is 1 million female more than male. In USA alone, there are 7.8 million female more than male. In UK alone, there are 4 million female more than male. In Germany alone, there are 5 million female more than male. In Russia alone, there are 9 million female more than male. And God alone knows how many millions of females are more than male throughout the world. If I agree with you that one man should only marry one woman, and suppose the market is saturated, and if your sister happens to live in America, or my sister happens to live in America, and if she happens to be one of the 7.8 million females who has not found a life partner, the only option for her is that she either marries a man who already has a wife, or she becomes public property. Public property, such a harsh word. This is the most sophisticated word I can use. I cannot think of a better word than this. And any modest woman would say that if the option is given, she would prefer marrying a man who already has a wife or become public property. Hope that answers the question.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Someone would like to have a shahada. That was the last. This was the last question actually, but we'll allow that shahada and inshallah we'll carry on with the other program.
So if we have to end the session early, I would request that if there are any people who would like to give the shahada, would like to accept Islam, they are most welcome to come on all the 5 microphones. Anyone, the volunteers, if anyone would like to give a shahada, we just have a couple of minutes before we end this program and have the next session. If any brothers and sisters who are interested in accepting Islam after attending the 10-day conference, they are most welcome to come on the microphone so that we can just have a last joint shahada session. If anyone in this microphone, how many brothers would like to give shahada? MashaAllah, so if there are two brothers, you would like to give a shahada.
Salaam alaikum.
Do you believe there is one God? Kya aap mante ki khuda ek hai?
Ek hi God karke yakeen rakhta hu.
Do you believe aap mante ki Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam aakhri paigambar hai?
Ha manta hu.
Aap mante? Aap pe koi zabardasti kar raha hai Islam qabul karne ke liye? Koi aap pe zabardasti kar raha hai?
Nahi.
आप अपने मर्जी से कबूल करना चाहते
हैं
इंशाल्लाह बोथ द ब्रदर्स इंशाल्लाह दे कैन से द शहादा जस्ट इन अरबिक एंड यू कैन रिपीट इट एंड देन वी कैन हैव द नेक्स्ट सेशन अशहदु
अशहदु
अल्लाह
अल्लाह
इलाहा
इलाहा
इल्लल्लाह
इल्लल्लाह
व
अशहदु
अन्ना
अन्ना
मुहम्मदन
मुहम्मदन
अब्दुहु
अब्दुहु
व रसूलुहु
व रसूलुहु मैं गवाही देता हूं
के अल्लाह
अल्लाह
के इलावा
इलावा
कोई माबूद नहीं
कोई माबूद नहीं
और मोहम्मद
मोहम्मद
सल्लल्लाहु
अलैहि वसल्लम उसके बंदे
और
पैगंबर है
माशाल्लाह आप मुसलमान हो चुके अल्लाह आपको जज़ाए खैर दे और अल्लाह आपको हिदायत दे और मैं दुआ करूंगा कि अल्लाह आपको जन्नत नसीब फरमाए एंड दिस एंड द सेशन एंड आई गिव इट टू माय ब्रदर टू इंशाल्लाह कंटिन्यू विद द नेक्स्ट सेशन
जज़ाकअल्लाह खैर ब्रदर वांट्स अ नेम टू
हेलो मेरा एक नाम
यू वुड लाइक अ नेम टू बी गिवन टू हिम
आप अपना नाम उमर रख सकते हैं उमर
Jazakallah khair. Khairhan. It was a wonderful session.